Hello everyone, my name is Sudhanshu and today I am going to demonstrate a video regarding implementation of SVM using Python on a sample dataset. SVM stands for Support Vector Machine. It is a category of supervised machine learning technique. It is used for classification, regression as well as outlier detection. Today we would use SVM to build and train a model using human cell records and classify the cells, that is cancer cells, to whether the samples are benign, that is class 1, or malignant, that is class 2. Benign are those class or those states which are mild state of cancer, and malignant are those states where the cancer is in evil state. So this implementation would span in 10 steps. First is necessary introduction, how SVM works, the necessary imports in Python about the data that we are going to operate on, loading the data from CSV file or we can also read it online, distribution of the classes to have a glance of it, selection of unwanted columns and removing the unwanted columns. So we have to identify the unwanted columns as well as rows, if there are any, and then removing them. Then we would divide the data or partition the data as train or test. Then we would apply a model and then finally we would evaluate how well the model performs. So these are the comments that I have already written in my Jupyter notebook. Let us input a cell below the first comment. I'll go to cell, insert a cell below here. So as I said, we use SVM to build and train models. And how SVM works? SVM works by mapping the data to a high dimensional feature space. That is, data points can be categorized by viewing them as per or with respect to another set of dimensions. Because as per the normal dimensions, it is very difficult to fit a hyperplane into it. So this job of visualizing or changing the aspect to see the data from a different set of dimensions, this job is getting done. It's done by kernel function. So that's what it is written here. SVM works by mapping data to a high dimensional feature space so that data points can be categorized even when the data are not otherwise linearly separable. What is meant here? Linearly separable means a simple line or a simple plane could not clearly segregate the two classes. As in this example, we are taking an example where the data has two kind of data points, like two classes are there. So a separator between the categories is found by using SVC, support vector classifier, and then the data is transformed in such a way that the separator could be drawn as a hyperplane. So I'll mark it down as a comment. Now, first, starting with the code, we need to import the necessary libraries. So, what all necessary libraries we would be using here? First is import pandas. We'll give it a nickname as PT. So, pandas is a library which helps us to create a new kind of data structure that is called as data frame. Data frame, we can visualize it just like an Excel sheet in which we have multiple rows and multiple columns. Each column could have individual column may have a homogeneous or heterogeneous kind of data types, as well as every column could be of different data type. So next, apart from this pandas, we would also be needing one more library, import numpy, and we'll give a nickname here also, np. So why we are giving nickname to it? Because NumPy is a library, or we can call it as a package. In this package there would be multiple methods that we would be using. So while accessing or while calling those methods, every time we would have to mention the name of the package dot method name, or we can specify the nickname dot method name. Another important import would be plotting package. So we have a package called as matplotlib. In this package there is a sub package called as pyplot. We'll give it a nickname as PLD. And so far, these three packages are the basic which we require, and if there is any more need, we can add them on the go. Yeah, I pressed shift enter and it ran successfully. Now let us talk about the data that we are going to import. So the data that we are going up about to import, it is about the breast cancer. It is about the breast cancer tumor which is available in patients. There are 700 samples, that means 700 records are there, or 700 rows are there. For each row, for each cancer cell, there are multiple parameters that have been measured and recorded. So let me put the description of the data here. This data was originally prepared by Oshanshian and Newman in 2011, available at UCI Machine Learning Repository, and the CSV file is also available at this public source which I have used. Each record contains, as I said, multiple values of a set of cell characteristics, as we can see here, field name and the description. What is the field name ID? Okay, this description must not be clump thickness, it is like identifier. Okay, it's just an identifier for that particular record or row. I must tell you, in this whole demonstration, I would be using few terms. In general, when we say row, that means a record, and when we say column, that essentially means attribute, or it might also mean as dimension, and one of the column, target column. Target column is the column that we are about to predict. So prediction that we are about to make, right? So these are the words that are being used interchangeably during the demonstration. Now, as I said, there are 10 columns: ID, clump, uniformity of the cell size, uniformity of the cell shape, marginal addition, and many more. And the final column, the target column, whose name is class, which will identify whether a particular record or particular row is of the class benign or malignant. Let us try to load the data from the comma separated value file, CSV file, which is available locally in my system. So the method which helps to load the data file, that method is read_CSV. read_CSV, and in bracket as an argument will give the name of the file. In this present local system, my file is also available at the same path where my present Jupyter notebook file is residing, and the name of the file is cell_samples.csv. So it's not necessary to put both the files at the same location. We can also put the files at different location, and we can give the entire path here. So this read_CSV method is available in the pandas library. So we have to mention name of the package from where we have taken this method. The output of this, or we can say return type of this method, is a data frame. So we give a name to that variable, data frame, or cell_data_frame, which is the output of this method, successfully read. Now comes to see how the classes are distributed. Before that, let us see whether how does the data look like. There is a method, data frame instance name, or the variable name, dot head. Head presents the first 5 rows of the data. So these are the first 5 rows we can see starting from 0, and accidentally all the classes, all the records have been mapped to same class. So rather we can see tail. So tail will give us last 5 rows. See, we have two type of classes here, malignant and benign. Benign has been given a value 2, malignant has been given a value 4 here. We can also see the shape of this data so that we can know how many values are there. It says 699 cross 11, so 11 rows are there. And if you want to see how much size it takes to get stored in the memory, so we can print the the size in bytes that has been occupied this particular variable of data frame type. Apart from that, we can also see there is a method called as count, which tells us column wise count of values available in each column. It has to be dot. Yeah, it says in ID column these many values are there, in clump these many values are there. We can see all of them are having same number of values available here. And if you want to see the count of values in a particular row for each type of value, for example cell underscore data frame, and if we take one particular column, let's say class, and in class only if you want to see that how many different type of values are there, I mean frequency of each type of entry, so that could be there would be a method called as value underscore counts. Here it is s counts, and I'll press enter. So it says in class column there is a value 2 which has or which is occurred 458 times, and another value 4 which has been occurred 241 times. Okay, and class column has a particular data type as int. Moving ahead, next is distribution of the classes. From the previous command we can see since out of 700 values, 699 values, 458 belong to class 1 and 241 belongs to another class. Two type of classes are there. Now we want to visualize this distribution on a graph so that if the data is too big, we can have a better look at it. So in order to plot a scatter graph or scatter plot, we need two values, one to be plotted on x-axis, another to be plotted on y-axis. Let us choose any two values out of this data frame. Let us choose clump and uniformity of cell size. Now what we would do, out of this cell data frame we would choose those rows which belong to malignant class only. So I'll write malignant data frame, which is a subset of cell underscore data frame that we have taken. And how do we decide which subset we want to take? We would just simply put a filter here. I'll write cell underscore data frame, those frames and in which the value of class column is equals to 4, because malignant was having a value 4. Out of all such rows I need only let's say first 200 rows only, so from 0 to 200, right? Similarly we would do it for benign. So benign has a class value 2, and we will give a different name, benign data frame. So what essentially we did, from the cell data frame we put in a filter or kind of the condition that we want only those rows or those columns, those rows for which the class attribute has a value of 2. Out of all such rows I just want to display only first 200 rows. Similarly for malignant, Once we are done this, next what we would do, we would call a method of this data frame class, data frame instance name dot, there is a method called as plot. Plot is a method which we use to plot different kind of plots. Here we want to plot scatter. So what we would do, we would give the corresponding name in the respective argument. So how do I know which arguments are applicable to a particular function? There is a help method available across the Python at all the levels. I simply write help and name of the class that you want, or name of the instance name, name of the method, or name of the attribute. So wherever we are stuck, we can seek help. So if you press help and name of the method, plot is a method here, so it would show us that plot is used for plotting, and it has different parameters that can be passed. So one of the parameter is x, another parameter is y, another parameter is kind. So these are the name of the parameters which has to be passed. So okay, see, kind can take accept input values, pi, area, density, box, histogram, bar, line, and many more. So this is how we can identify what has to be passed as an argument in a particular function, and what all are methods or attributes that we can use for a particular instance of a given type. So I would write benign dot plot, and within brackets I would specify what kind of plot I do want. Kind is scatter. Scatter plot I would like to plot, and the x and y, as I have already decided, x should be the, here we could see, x should be the clump size and y should be the uniformity of the cell size. So I write clump, it is case sensitive, you must be careful while writing the spelling, and uniformity of cell size. Apart from this, we can also mention whether the color of these dots or points, what color do we like to display. So color, we can take it as blue. And label means we are specifying the legend or labels that would be placed at the top corner, top right or top left corner of the graph. Label, I want to display it as benign. Similarly, we will do it for malignant data frame. In this case, we will plot it with a different color. Now, here, the plot method of data frame class returns a pair of axes. A-X-E-S. It's a plural word. So, these axes are just the set of x-axis and y-axis. So, now if I, let me help you understand it better. If I run this command, so it would be plotted here, just like this. And if I would run another command for the another, like after plotting benign, if I run malignant, it would be plotted as a separate graph. But this is not what we desired. We desired to visualize both kind of points of both kind of classes in the same graph. So what can be done is, there is another parameter called as AX, which represents axis on which you want to plot this particular data. So as a value, I can give AX equal to AXES. So AX is the parameter name. AXES is the return which we received from the previous command, AXES. So now if we would run, we can see output of both the commands in the same graph. Next step is identifying the unwanted rows. So if we have a data, it need not necessarily be having all the data values, all the cells of the same type or numerical type. So we need to verify it first. So how do we verify? The name of the original data was cell underscore data frame, and there is an attribute data types. So it will show us what are the data types of individual column. Here we can see where the UPI column is having the data type as object, which is not a numeric value. That means we cannot apply mathematical operations on this particular column entirely. So what we need to do is, we need to do some modification onto it. So what kind of modification we can do? For all the rows where the value is non-numeric, we have to choose, we have to decide what we can do. We can put a mean value of that column at that positions where the value is missing or the value is non-numeric, or we can simply find out the another suitable value for that particular cell. There are techniques such as min-max technique, finding the mean and putting it, substituting it there, and there is a technique using oversampling, and similar many other techniques are there. So what next we can do here is we can let's do one thing. Let us just simply remove the non-numerical data. I mean, for a particular row, if that row in a particular column bare nuclei, if the values are non-numeric, we would simply discard that row. It is up to you, and depending upon the situation, if you are not able to substitute a suitable value, it is not good to consider that as well, because the synthetic data would not contribute to the right decisions. So how do we do it? For doing so, we need to call a function. We would do it in two steps. First, we would convert all the values of that bare nuclei column to numeric. So in order to do it, there is a method in pandas library whose name is to_numeric. In this method, we would pass the particular column, cell_data_frame, and the name of the column was bare nuclei. And we would ensure that forcefully all the values are converted to numeric type. So I have passed this parameter with a value of coeds. Alternatively, we have a choice of ignoring. So in that case, we would pass the value as ignore, or we can raise it. So in that case, we would type raise as a string here. So pandas.toNumeric method is okay now. So this will give me a data frame. So what I would do with this data frame is I would pick only those rows where it could not convert into numeric by calling another method, not null. Not null is a method which helps to picking only non-missing rows, only those rows where this column value is available, those rows only would be picked up. So output of this we can store back in the same variable cell_data_frame. Now if we want to verify what happened after this is, we can again check the data types of all the columns. Here we can see that now bare nuclei is having all the values converted to numeric, but still it is showing as object. We need to convert it into integer now. So how do we do it? So write cell_data_frame. In this data frame, we'll pick the bare nuclei column. In this column, we would ensure by forcefully converting it into using a method astype. Astype means assure that this type is converted into the type which is given as an argument, astype, ascertain type as int. So this has been done now, and saving the same result back into the same column. So right side of the equal to would be evaluated first and then would be put back into left side. So now if we run this command, we can see bare nuclei has been converted into 32-bit integer now. Next is to remove unwanted columns. Let us see what all columns do we have in our cell data frame. So I'll write name of the instance dot columns. Columns is an attribute of this data frame class. So it would show me for this particular data frame all these columns are available here. So I'll copy all of them. And what I would do, I'll only select the relevant ones. I'll paste and I'll just simply remove ID, because ID is the identifier of each record which is not going to contribute for calculating the next prediction, and we would also remove the class attribute. Why I'm removing class attribute, I'll just tell you, because what I am trying to do now is I'm trying to make the independent variable, where variable itself is a data frame here. So how do I do it? I would simply create a feature set, or rather give a meaningful name, relevant column, as per your liking. So how do I create a feature data frame out of the given data frame? So from the cell data frame, I would pick only those whose name are mentioned here. So from cell data frame, we have filtered out two columns, ID and class. Now I'll convert this feature data frame into NumPy and ND array. What is NumPy ND array? It's just like a normal array. We call it as NumPy n-dimensional array. Why we are converting it into NumPy ND array? Because that would be passed as an argument to our next function that we are about to use. It is our choice. We can pass it as it is as a data frame also, or we can pass it as NumPy array in train test split method. So I'll make x equals to NumPy, which we have already imported in the beginning. Here it is, NumPy. So I'll call a method here, NumPy dot as array, a certain array, and in bracket I'll give the name of this data frame from which I have to make the array. So what is x here? Let me help you explain. Suppose we have a data set or number of records as 100. Let's say cell underscore data frame has 100 rows, right? So out of which, what I did, I am just, and let's say, and 11 columns initially. Now I have only picked or filtered out 9 columns out of it. I have removed ID and I have removed the class out of 11. So now I would be left with all the rows and only 9 columns after removing ID and class. That would be called as X. Why X? X denotes independent variable. Independent means the variables, here it is a data frame or an array itself. It means variable which is going to contribute for making the prediction of our dependent variable. So here dependent variable would be called as Y. In the same way, Y would be made out of numpy.as array, and rather than taking all the columns, we would take only cell, the column whose name was class, cell underscore data frame, and the column whose name was class. Yeah, things have been done successfully. Let us check. So for X, we can plot just few elements. So I'll write from 0 to 5. First five elements I would like to print. So we can see 5 elements have been printed. If you notice, this entry, this one element itself is an array. So that is internal structure of NumPy n-dimensional, ND arrays, how it works. Even if the actual shape of the array is 5 cross 2 or 5 cross 2 cross 4, or it could be anything, but internally it stores in a sequential manner where each element could itself be an array. So here it is showing first 5 elements where each element itself is an array, and all of these elements, these should be 9 entries. So because we picked 9 columns here as a part of X, which is independent. Similarly, if we would check for Y, which is dependent, here we have 5 corresponding entries. So 2 here represents it belongs to class whose value is 2. Now comes dividing the entire data as training part and testing part. Suppose we have the data, the entire data, that we called it as cell underscore data frame. We would divide this data into training part and the test part. For the training part itself, this is multi-line comment in Python. Cell data frame was divided into train and test, where train has two components, let's say X and Y, and similarly test does also have two components, X and Y, where X itself is a X itself is a 2D array and Y is one dimensional array. Here also Y is one dimensional array. So what exactly I want to say is, for example, in training part, test train based on number of rows. For example, if the cell data frame had 100 rows with it, the training part, we can make it as 80 rows for training and rest of the 20 rows for testing. Right? Within the training part, where X denotes the number of columns which are independent and Y denotes the dependent, that is the column that we are going to predict. Let me first divide the data into train and test, and we can check the shape so that we can have a better understanding. To do it, we need to call a method train underscore test underscore split. Train test split. This method is available in scikit-learn package, model selection sub package, and this is a method available there. So we need to import that first. Import scikit-learn and model selection. Model underscore model selection. And from this package, I want to import only one method. So I'll write from this package, import only one relevant method that I want to use. It is done now. In this, I would pass as argument the X and Y that I have just created before. X I have created for the entire data. X was this, having 9 columns, all the rows. Y was given small y as a name, 9, 1 column, all the rows. Also, we would specify the proportion that we want to keep it as a test size. So, I'll write test underscore size equals to 0.2. Up to us, we can also keep it as small as possible. And there is another parameter, random underscore state. Random underscore states accepts a value as a seed value. What is seed value? Seed value is just a number which is used to generate other random numbers. Those random numbers which would be generated by this particular seed value would be used to identify which all rows has to be chosen to place them as a part of training set or training data, and the rest of it would be considered as test data. Now output of this method would give us 4 arrays, NumPy arrays, and first is the X component of the training set, X component of the testing set, Y component of training set, Y component of the testing set. So in this precise order only, and we can check the shape by calling that property. So x underscore train dot shape would be 546 cross 9. That means 546 rows and 9 columns. So it is considering 546 records to train the model. Essentially, similarly, the y component, corresponding y component of the training data would also have same number of rows, 546 rows. So I'll just write it here. 546 cross 9. So y component of the training data, let us see what is the output. It is also having same number of rows, 546 cross 9. And let us check for testing part. For testing part also, x test would have rest of the amount of the rows, that is 137. And similarly, 137 number of rows would be available in y underscore test dot shape. I am already writing it as 137 cross 1. We can run and see the output. Yeah, 137 cross 1. Now the second last step is modeling. Modeling is done using SVM package. SVM package is available in scikit-learn. So we are only importing only one package, one sub package. So that is why I am writing from sklearn, from this package, import only one sub package. If I want to import only one method, I would write from sklearn.svm import one particular method only. Now this method, this SVM package has multiple methods, one of which is relevant for us is SVC. What is SVC? SV is support vector classifier. What is support vector classifier? Support vector classifier refers, or it means, those data points near to the hyperplane whose distance, perpendicular distance to the hyperplane, if we sum that up for all the points, nearby points of the hyperplane, and maximize that distance, such data points would be called as support vectors or support vector classifiers. Let me reiterate it. It means those data points whose distance from the hyperplane we calculate individually and then sum that up. If that sum is maximum as compared to other hyperplane, then such set of data points would be called as support vector classifiers. So support vector classifier is a method in SVM which accepts an argument, a parameter kernel. Kernel, I have already explained in the beginning of the lecture that kernel is a function which helps, or which itself visualizes, or we can say which sees the data from a different perspective, different set of dimensions, so that it could easily fit a hyperplane, which we could not have been able to fit easily for the given dimension. So kernel, we can place options like linear or RBF or many other type of kernels are there. I'll just put them in comment. So we have linear, polynomial, radial basis function and sigmoid, four type of kernels supported in SVC, out of which if we do not specify the kernel, the default would be RBF. For each kernel, we also need to specify what would be the corresponding coefficients, kernel coefficients, which would be used for calculating the hyperplane for with respect to a new set of dimensions. So that we call it as gamma. So let me write it here. So I can mention that gamma, that is kernel coefficients, can be calculated by auto mechanism. Let the system call it by its own. There is one more thing called as C. What is C? C denotes the penalty or the cost. Better we can call it as penalty. C denotes the penalty that we want to impose on the incorrectly placed data points with respect to the new hyperplane. Hyperplane is just a segregator. It's just a line or could be a plane which segregate two classes. So if a point which ideally should have been in class 1, but it is residing in class 2 as per with respect to the hyperplane, that is, it is incorrectly placed with respect to the hyperplane, such incorrect data points would cost us something, and there would be penalty for it, that we call it as C. So we write C like 1.5 or 2 or something, we can write 2. That means we imply 2 units of penalty for such data points. This is for just one point. C equal to 2 for one point, and for every such wrongly identified points, it would be 2 multiplied by those many number of wrongly identified points. Now I'll press shift enter. So it says SVM model has been built with all these attributes. The attributes which I have not given have been taken, and they have taken the default value. The output of SVC method is an instance of classifier. So I'll put it in a variable named as classifier. Now I'll use this variable to fit the model. So I'll use the method of classifier.fit. This is a general method, and it fits the data. It reads the data, and based on the pattern of the data, data has two components, x and y. It reads the data, and based on the pattern in x and y, it prepares the model. So I'll pass x component, x underscore train, comma y component, y underscore train. The reason why I have taken x as capital and y as small initially as the name of the variable, because x denotes multi-dimensional data and y denotes only one dimensional data, because y is just the class that we want to predict. So once we are done this, so our classifier is also ready. Now let us predict the output. So I'll write classifier dot predict. So how do I predict? I would simply pass the testing portion and x component of the testing portion only, and the output of this predict would be one dimensional array. So I'll give it a name as y predict, y underscore predict, classifier dot predict. Okay, so once the prediction has been done, what next? Very obvious, we would have to compare y predict versus y test, where y test denotes the actual value of the classes of each of the record available in x test, and y predict is the classes predicted by the our system that we have just made out of it. Let's go to evaluating the results. How good are the results we have? So in order to evaluate the results, many functions are already inbuilt. There is a function or method called as classification report. How good the classifier is. In this, we would pass both two arguments. The first, which was actual classes, and second, which have been predicted by the system. This method is actually available in the matrix package of sklearn, so we have to import that as well. So I'll write from sklearn dot matrix package import classification report method. Please note we do not have to put these pair of braces here, and we can simply call it here simply. Now we would print the output of this classification report. It says error. Why? It says y test is not defined, because I have incorrectly put it in here. So we have the report with us. It says precision is 100% for class, one of the class, and 90% for another class. for one of the class, the value in the class column was 2, that is for benign, and the class value was 4 for malignant patients. So these are the two classes, 2 and 4. Precision, recall, F1 score and support is there. What is precision? Precision is the ratio of true prediction upon true prediction plus false prediction. That means out of totally, let's say, we have to understand it using a confusion matrix. So what is the confusion matrix? Confusion matrix is a matrix where we make a 2 cross 2 grid and we decide how many true positive, false positive, true negative, false negative, all those 4 type of values have been calculated. Once we are done with this, we identify how many out of all the predicted positives, where positive means those patients who have actually a very severe state of cancer. Okay, so out of all the predicted positives, predicted cancers, how many are the right predictions? So that is true positives upon true positive plus false positive. Whereas recall is out of total actual cancer patients, how many have been severe cancer patients, how many have been predicted by the system. So there is a small difference between precision and recall. Whereas F1 score is a harmonical mean of precision versus recall, that is 2 times precision into recall upon precision plus recall. And the support means how many instances or how many cases of class 2, that is negative, were there, and how many instances of class 4, that means positive, evil state of cancer, such instances were there in my test. We can add, if we add it up, 90 plus 47, that would become 137. That was the result of our test data set. So this is our final evaluation results. So that's all from my side. Let us have a very quick recap. We introduced what is SVM. Then we started with importing necessary libraries. Then at the next step, we explained about the data, source of data, different columns in the data. And then we started with loading the data. We read about the data, that how it looks like, how much size it occupies, and for each column, what are the different type of values it has. If then we visualize the data on scatter plot, because it is not easy to examine everything numerically by looking at the numbers only. So graph tells a lot many things. So identifying the unwanted rows where the cells have missing values or the missing values cannot be substituted by our own knowledge. So we can simply drop those rows, or we can calculate the missing values using some techniques. Standard techniques are there, like mean or min-max or simple minority oversampling technique. Similarly, we can remove unwanted columns, like ID was not contributing to the calculation of next prediction. And we have also removed class from the X component, because class would become the Y component. Then we divided the train and test into 20% and 80%, where 80% is the training data. For training data and test data, we have X component, Y component. X component is having 9 columns, Y is having 1 column. So we can see the shape here. So this is the training data and this is the testing data. Now out of once the data has been divided, we apply the model. The model is SVM here. SVM can accept 4 type of kernel function: linear, polynomial, RBF or sigmoid. And I have already told that kernel, if it is linear or sigmoid or RBF, it also needs gamma parameter. What is gamma? Gamma is the kernel coefficient, which tells that for evaluating the other dimensions, or I mean for evaluating those dimensions which would help to visualize the data from a different perspective, what should be the coefficients. So here the gamma, if it is auto, it uses 1 upon number of features as the value, and if it is scale, then it uses 1 upon number of features into the variance of X component. And C is the cost, or the rate of penalizing the wrong side of placement the wrong placement of data points on the of the hyperplane, I mean points which are on the wrong side of the hyperplane. Now once the classifier is built, we would make the prediction, based on the testing component, X part of the testing component, and then we would compare X this predicted value versus the actual value. Actual value was Y test, it is Y predict. We would compare, we would print the results. The results are in the form of precision, recall, F1 score and support. So that's all from my side. Thank you for patiently listening.